Hey, Uncle, just do practice?
That old thing? Your dad gave it to me. Otherwise, I would have used it for firewood a long time ago. I see you've kept up.
Just sometimes.
Episode. I thank you all for coming here and spending some time with me to review a little bit more into the history of what we call in Chinese martial arts the wooden dummy or the mukian zhong. In many of these other systems, it might go by other names. And so rather than worrying about what they call it, you can tell in all of these videos we're about to watch that these fellows are training on approximately the same kind of apparatus. It's a wooden post that comes from the ground up, and it often has arms and legs. So we're going to go into it. So this very first set is what they call HungGar. And again, I'm not too well versed on all these people's lineages or names. This is, again, I'm coming in from a Wing Chun perspective. I've seen in the last episode, we went into every video we could find almost on Wing Chun style wooden dummy. And now we're going to take a walk through the history from a Wing Chun lens and take a look at these other forms. Okay, so we'll go right into it. So this is HungGar wooden dummy. Looks the same, but you'll notice it looks like it has two lower arms. And like right out of the gate, he's in this low stance. But strategically, immediately, you can see that they work the corners. I love this. It gets low. And so if you saw what Wing Chun was doing in the last video series that we just did, see the previous episode, there's quite a large difference in the design of people's postures from what Wing Chun folks do to what this gentleman is doing. He's nice and low. I guess you could say he's hunched it a little bit, like his head is forward. That might just because he's focused. But I love how crisp it is. I love how many techniques are in here. And how they work the low positioning. Makes sense now why there's two arms for the bottom. It gives you more to study against. Those lower arms could be either a person's knee or a kick or a low punch. This goes down, he sweeps the legs. So I always say, anybody wants to know the difference, HungGar has a very large library and then, of course, takes these low positions, which are great for grappling and resistance of grappling, for takedowns. So if you're looking for, you know, a journey through a very old system with a lot of options, look no further. Love these hammer fists, all kinds of claws. Really cool. Really cool. Right? Just the one time. Next. XingYi. Now, I did the best I could to try to find people who I thought were doing a good job at this. So this is somebody I found that's doing what he called XingYi dummy. And again, like now this one has no leg, but it's the same concept here is that we've got arms and a single vertical pile going up. I love the look of this. If you understand weapons, I love it's got another set of arms on the other side. And if you understand XingYi, it's it drives the broadsword. And it can drive the spear. So having something to work against, they rip the face. You see that's a sword drop, clear. We're going to watch it one more time, or a little just replay for us here. So just looking at the shapes, much different, but similar to what we just saw. Attacking the side, I love that shoulder bump. That's unique to these guys. I guess if there was a leg, maybe some of those kicks might be appearing. And I always guess, is this a form or is this a guy freestyling? It has a relationship. It looks almost like he's doing the same thing, but maybe he's just freestyling. Yeah, like awesome. Rips. Okay. Pretty awesome. XingYi dummy. I'll leave the links to all these down below, and you'll be able to watch exactly the whole footage. If there's more to this here, of course, with the sound, you can hear these guys hitting it. This next one is BakMei wooden dummy. Now, again, same concept here, different stand. This is so cool. It has two legs. So we're going to watch this fellow work. Right. Already taking some different things, but things we just saw, like in the HungGar, where he's bridging with forearm pieces. This footwork is a little bit more moderate, so he doesn't appear to be taking too far of a low position. I love that there's two legs. I think it's really cool. And I've seen many of these before I published this here, so I have some ideas. I love the push-pull, and he uses the dummy to help him. Bridge hand strikes, elbow strikes, sweeps. There's a piece coming up where he takes both the legs. Hang on, let's see if he does it. Boom, sweep. So cool. Now, you could do this with a single leg, but it's pretty awesome that there is a double leg for that specific maneuvers that you get to do an ankle pick. And again, yeah, so takedowns, like maybe that's what the older systems have. That's a hallmark, is they're sometimes taking wider stances, going all the way in for the elbow strike. Some of their designs are different. These arms, I guess, would be considered maybe a little bit too long for it to be a Wing Chun dummy. We're going to watch them again. Hold on. And, of course, the double leg is an indicator that this is not a Wing Chun dummy. I love it. Just traps it underneath, breaks, arm destructions. The footwork is mostly stepping, like just sliding back. So he does a lot of sliding back. I love the push-pull, where you can use the dummy to give yourself like a little push resistance. Bridge hand strikes, push-pull, you see with the elbow, into the elbow. If you freestyle or you work on a partner, you can get that great effect where you can rebound force them. And it's not easy to accomplish, and you don't see it a lot in a lot of the dummies. You see that the guys just kind of shape moves and walk around it. If you can actually push-pull a little bit, this thing can knock you around and you can almost climb around it. Again, like, so from a Wing Chun perspective, these shapes, these choreographies are all over the spectrum. You could almost say he's taking some very risky things, like, you know, ducking or turning his body too far sideways. But again, this is just a training tool. So you can do anything you want to do. These old systems have maintained a modality that they operate under. So they always shape it the same way. They're making maneuvers that are from their other forms. Okay, we're going to keep going. Now, I don't know the, no warranty, I don't know this fellow's lineage also, but he's calling it Shaolin Eagle Claw style Kung Fu, or Ying Zhao. So we're going to go into that. This looks more like a Wing Chun dummy, and probably rightfully so it is. And so who knows if this is what Eagle Claw does, or if this is just what him and his lineage do. I couldn't find much more on Eagle Claw. If you guys, anybody study Eagle Claw, you want to share a dummy set from your art, we'd love to have our eyes walk through it and say we understand it. Again, you see all these different stand designs. So some of those were on the wall. Some of those were in the ground on a spring. This one is in its own sort of portable stand, so he could be part of whatever this demonstration is about. I know I'm talking through it, but you can see when a form is at play or when it's just freestyling. Most of these, again, appear to be forms. Maybe that XingYi one was a bit of form and then a bit of freestyling. Maybe that's their form. As a Wing Chun player, I like to see that they're double-sided. I love symmetry. This is very distinct, like he just kneeled. And you don't see that shape in Wing Chun. You'll see this, however, in the other Shaolin systems. Low squats, low sweeps. We just saw the double takedown. Against a competition, and this is a student, so he's obviously got eyes on him, and he might be, you know, freezing mentally. So we're not judging how good this guy is. I think if he calls it Eagle Claw, what we'd be judging is the differences from system to system. What makes this Eagle Claw? What are some of the moves they do that you could pick out that would tell you it's Eagle Claw? And, yeah, right? So I don't know. I don't know how good he is or if that's the official one, but that's the one we could find for this demonstration. I think just in general, just has a lot of moves flying all over the place. Here's another one, Tai Chi Praying Mantis. This, you can tell when a person is very well trained in Kung Fu arts, you can see it in their hands. And so some of these folks you can see, you could tell they have a lot of power. Whether they're using it in these maneuvers is another story. Anytime you see somebody jumping or skipping out of stances, it just tells you that that style has got an active footwork base, or meaning to say maybe they kick a lot or they trip a lot. That's part of their method. And I know that when you change your feet, you change your ground routine, and so you don't have as good a connection when you're changing. But if you're sweeping a person, so they're very, very different. Now, he calls it Tai Chi Mantis, but maybe this is Mantis. If you studied either of those two systems, you could pick up what would be Tai Chi specifically. Mantis, from my experience, looks very similar to Wing Chun. Again, just organized differently as an art form and some of their favorite moves. Definitely something I notice in the years training with other folks that did this style is that they, in other kung fu arts, they didn't care about turning their back. In the Wing Chun, we were taught, at least in my school, that you don't turn your back. You're going to get choked out, or you get knocked out, or you get your face shredded. So as a habit, you try never to allow the back of you to face the dummy. And so I'll demonstrate. I'll explain that in some of the shapes this gentleman makes. So he mostly is on the sides, working trips, deflections, combinations of highs and lows, right? Some awesome tripping maneuvers. If you understand tripping, he's tripping constantly. Low horse from the HungGar, combination of highs and lows, right? That, like turning, is something that you can do. If you're good at martial arts, you want to spin, you could totally spin. I don't think it'll matter. But as a habit, it's not a great idea to turn your flank to anybody for any reason, unless you have no choice. But then in these old systems, these were not about like necessarily what's the ultimate, what's the best. It was a collection of things you could and should do, depending on what your maneuver was. So sometimes when you kick too far. And let's see if I can find a spot where he kicks. You kick too far, and you need to recover from that kick, and then so another kick or spin can be a reasonable thing that you might do afterward. What makes this look like other systems of Kung Fu specifically, although this is sort of a Wing Chun dummy, is that, you know, he's taking very big shapes. They're stepping, there's not really pivoting. And, of course, the jumping and the turning. If you just saw two guys, a guy doing Wing Chun and a guy doing this, you think that this system was more, you know, energetic and probably maybe more effective. But then when you see the Wing Chun ones, they're more quiet and simplistic. So you get into this conversation on effectiveness. Are all of these moves necessary? Are they valuable? It's a question I'm asking out loud. When you see the small wooden dummy shapes of the Wing Chun style and the refined posturing and the refined angulation versus these larger, more wild, jumpy styles, you can say that the older Kung Fus are a little bit more wild, I would say, than the Wing Chun. Next, ChoyLiFut. And yeah, so they call theirs Qingzhong. Again, new design. This is maybe his own designing, but one thing you could tell it's ChoyLiFut is they have this really awesome, you know, pulling element where, and they often you'll see that they develop their arm bridges, so they're striking targets. Two low arms, a single leg. Again, this design is right into the ground. You can tell it's not related to some of these other systems, but it has a look like the HungGar, and it has some of the shapes, like maybe what we saw some of the XingYi, large shapes and some cross-through steps like what he's doing now. Yeah, is that it? No, I think he'd do it again. Hold on. Qingzhong, angle one, part two. I'm going to go back to this shape just because this does look like some form sequencing. Now, again, I'm a Wing Chun guy, so I see ChoyLiFut as like a foreign language. Although it's MMA, it's martial arts, it's takedowns, it's kicking, boxing, striking, you know, shoulder bumps, takedowns. I love all of this work. And then if you study and you see their weaponry, it no longer becomes a foreign language. You understand that they're driving a spear or the two-handed sword or the bow staff. And with the bow staff, these moves make sense. As a boxing system, I guess you could just say they're kind of big. So this is referred to maybe in Wing Chun language as a long bridge system. Forget now. Let's see if there's a second part. We'll go into it. I love this. I'm not trying to negative any of this work. It is big. It's considered long hand. So if a guy's taller than you, stronger than you, you know, leverage is much different out at the wrists of a person. And when you're in the longer range, you can deploy kicks. You can evade. So there's value to being far enough away. We're going back to that. That was really cool. Really cool. Okay. I guess, yep, next chapter. So like many organized martial arts systems, when you see a form that's done, that's symmetrical, that's done in parts, that's great. That's so you're learning a variety of sequences and you don't have to learn, you know, 400 movements all at once. You can get 20 or 30 and work inside that. I love that this arm is here because you have something you can now go underneath. So again, another hallmark of these bigger, older kung fu systems. I'm calling it older because I believe that they're more closely related to their Shaolin ancestors than Wing Chun is. So the Wing Chun is a modern concept. It's only a couple hundred years old, this idea of minimalism and mass efficiency and very refined angles and minimalist footwork. This is wild fighting by that standard. But it's got the hallmarks of kicking and punching as one piece, blocking and attacking as one shape. You meet anybody that does this work that knows the level this guy has, you're going to get hurt. You spar with them, you know, if you would ever freestyle and just experience what it's like to cross bridges with somebody who's been developing long bridge power on, and they're at the Zhong level, these people are going to have forearms like stone. And, well, that's okay. So you would use a soft hand approach in order to manage against that big extra power. If I was a little tiny person, this is a good conversation. If I was a little tiny person and my method was long bridge and I met somebody who's bigger than me, that's method is also long bridge, you could say that the little person would get destroyed. So when your energy is not as big or your power potential is not as big as someone else, it's valuable to have that yin system or that yin style system where you would go softness against hardness or you would go angulation against mass power. And so, anyway, beautiful presentation. This fellow is obviously well-trained. Again, I don't know his lineage, but shout out to him. I'll leave the links in the video description down below. Let's keep going. Next. He says, best wooden dummy in the world. What did I say this one? I think this is ChoyLiFut. Okay. Now, again, I don't know anybody's lineage. I just search for these things. It's very difficult to find anybody that's not Wing Chun that's got this form or a form of this going out. We would look at this now. We've seen a couple of these, and if you were with me for the previous episode for the walkthrough of all the Wing Chun wooden dummy forms, you'd look at this and you'd cringe really bad because, his tail's out and he's wearing a karate outfit and it's just too crazy and too fast. And it's okay. Like, maybe that's how this works. That's their style. They're fast and they change a lot. Anybody does what is this one called? Excuse me. This is called ChoyLiFut. Anybody who's got history in ChoyLiFut, is this guy doing a good job? You want to say yes or no? Please chime in the comments. I'll totally leave them open. We're going to go back to the beginning of it. It's a lot of Xing, a lot of moving. Obviously, he knows he's on film. He wants to go quick, show off for us, show off for the channel. There's value to demonstrating a power form. Anybody that wants to share theirs and do it fast. But to get the most out of these devices, it's not necessarily how fast you go is the value that you get out of them. It can be maybe how you use them in a creative way. Of course, if there's forms, you can just lean on these old methods. But pushing and pulling, angulating and stepping, having something to kick and punch as one, it's a nice value. It's much, much different of a training tool than what you'd get of a heavy bag or even a friend holding shields. Although I love shield work. Right, let's just see, maybe another angle. I love shield focus mitt work. Haven't had so many decades now in Jeet Kune Do. It can be very creative and a lot of fun to have a coach hold shields for you. When you don't have a partner, though, what are you supposed to do? How are you supposed to grow? So the heavy bag is an obvious, easy thing you could adapt. But ancestors were way more creative, and there's legends that in Shaolin they had come up with countless numbers of designs of these things. And so here's evidence of that. When Shaolin fractured, each of these systems sort of crystallized themselves. Again, to my previous videos, I believe that the systems were formed based on the weapons that they needed to deploy. So large movements, large weapon, short movements, short weapon. This logic pervades just about all the systems. When you get into modern systems now, they're lost. They're just boxing arts or self-defense systems. Let's keep going. Next. Let's see. I believe this one's also Praying Mantis. What he calls Praying Mantis Dummy. And always I can tell if it's something as Mantis because there's jumping. I studied with a few folks for the years that had some experience in that system. And they were all, I thought, pretty well schooled on it, at least for the basic methods. And although I never met anybody that had this dummy set, you see some of their other boxing forms, they were just as gymnastic, acrobatic. Again, sweeping. So this looks like the other fellow who had that turning kick. This fellow's obviously going quick and I think doing a very nice job, very precise. He's not sliding around too bad or tripping. The floor looks like it's providing pretty good grip. Again, they're turning. Was that the same kick as before? I don't know if this is a matching set. And then you're supposed to do this again on the other side. We're going back. I love this fellow's work. I think he's obviously well-schooled. And, you know, again, if you can memorize this and you practice on this regularly, you're going to have good kung fu. You're going to have tough forearms. Although toughness isn't the main point, it can be something that you do develop here. Every time you make a move and you smack into one of the weapons or one of the angles of this thing, you can be toughening your bones and strengthening your muscles. Certainly learning how to flow through where there would be empty territories. I think it's a testament to the brilliance of mankind that they would develop such organized routines for such a funny looking piece of training equipment. This looks like a Wing Chun shape dummy. So obviously, some of these other styles had two legs or two lower arms. And there's another ChoyLiFut dummy, which I'll have to continue to search for, but where it has a neck and it has other elements. So the last ChoyLiFut one we saw had that arm that pulled down. All right, we're going to keep going. Here's another one. I love these two guys, like an old man and a son, and they're infamous on Instagram. I don't know that he's his son, but he's certainly his protege. And they're in some native village. And this is another training tool, which you could call a wooden dummy. Common in a lot of older systems. You see this in like 36 Chambers of Shaolin. There's all these tools that they fight with. Here are these guys playing with it. And they've invented something recently, which is just like this, certainly inspired by this, called the Spar Bar. And shout out to Spar Bar. I've only used one of those one time. And it's like, you could really go nuts with the thing. We're going to watch this again. Where you hit it and it hits you back. With the Spar Bar, it just spins one single arm. The old version is this double one. I love he's got ropes on or something, and so it was going with him. Him and the old man doing what are the BaGua steps as they walk around this. It's just so cool. Makes you wish that you had a little more training space in your gym. You could put one of these guys in there. And again, like you don't necessarily need something that's extremely well designed in terms of its carving. It could just be two logs and a post.
One more.
This is BaGua Zhang dummy training, or you can just call it BaGua. And I've skipped forward. I thought I was going to be disappointed with this video and then watched a couple times, and I'm really impressed with the art. If you know what their weapon is, they drive a deer horn knife and also swords and sometimes a double sword. So I'm going to let this play. And you can see noticeable difference is that it's freestanding and has arms that spin. And, you know, this doesn't look like a form. This looks like a fellow training, but he's going through a series of matching things. Always people know they're on video, so maybe they might not be training as smooth as what they might do if they were doing slow motion work. So I don't know this fellow. I don't know his work, but no hard marks for the styling he's putting in. At this point, it doesn't matter to me. I'm interested in the difference of this training modality from the others. What gives it a signature look that makes it BaGua, and of course, how they modified their dummy to provide them with the attributes that they want to have. So this top arm that spins, I think, is awesome. Some of them I've seen that were fixed, and then you have to walk around them. Something that's signature, you see this in BaGua, they spin their back to the opponent often. If you know what they mean, their takedowns or their redirects, they could be very valuable in combat. You watch a wrestler, they slip the corner and they spin on people constantly. So knowing that application, you don't really worry about it. But this dummy gives you that change of that spin. Again, like that Spar Bar concept. See if I can find a video of that next and show you what that is. Some people might be familiar with it. So this is, again, like so cool that he's got a thing that moves on him. I suppose that makes it difficult to make a very exacted styling in your form. It's going to force you to be a little bit chaotic. Some of the angles might be bigger or smaller because of wherever that thing is when you pick it up. And there he is. Okay, so he was just freestyling. BaGua dummy. Okay. Okay, next. It is Wing Chun, but it's such a unique, different thing that this fellow is doing that I wanted to share it. And when you see it moving, you'll say, yeah, that's Wing Chun, but this is clearly something else. This is what they call a bamboo dummy. And so you can see one thing that would make it uniquely look like Wing Chun is it's narrow. And if we could see his footwork, maybe you'd say, yeah, the footwork is changing exactly like the shoulders and hips are. But this is a pretty interesting training tool where it's a number of posts, flexible posts, on a box array, and you can use it for developing the different heights of high and low defensive shapes. So he's just doing gansaos and poxaos, kaosaos, and punch elements. And I think it's just really cool that there are just so many of these other designs, and I don't know that he's good or bad. I'm just talking out loud, and he happened to be demonstrating it. Props to him for sharing this. Looks like fair Wing Chun to me, like in that he's turning, and it's nice and clean. He's using the empty space, and that's a key to these wooden dummies, is the territory between the targets are what you're learning how to flow into. I like that there's so many of these posts, so, you know, I guess you don't want to slouch forward because you're going to get eye gouged by the top row. Maybe that's one comment, is that he shouldn't have his head forward, he's going to get poked in the head. But clearly that's Wing Chun framing, but just fascinating, yeah, bamboo dummy. So we're going to keep going. Next. Again, we're still in Wing Chun land because it's almost impossible to find work on this thing without seeing some Wing Chun. But this is not, I wish I had had this in my previous video, but this is just something I stumbled upon and I love its look. So I'm going to share this one. We're calling it Opera Wing Chun. And in the origins of Wing Chun, in its fracturing from Shaolin, there's legend that they refugeed in the Red Junk Opera. And so that was a safe haven for a lot of martial artists. And in fact, almost everybody that was a performer was an accomplished martial artist. And you'll be able to tell this is Wing Chun, but you'll be able to see quickly that this has a look of HungGar, it has a look of Shaolin, and it picks up a tone of these other systems that we just watched. So anyway, commentary. My favorite look of this is that his posture is really nice. Upright and strong, clean. First thing he did was bend his knees. As I said, all of that, I believe, is the salute. Okay, now it begins. Phoenix eye punch. Arm breaks. Neck breaks. He's now on one side. I guess the one first comment I could say when I first saw this was that in some of this, if this is his early chapter, is that he's a little too far away for the standards of the typical Wing Chun. We like to crowd. But this leg design that's on the thing he's using, I don't know if that's intentional or maybe that's why he's modifying, because that thing is a peculiar shape. But it's still the same. You're seeing angulations and flow. This is a lot more precise than all these other people. And this, again, like tells you that it's Wing Chun. Is the work of Wing Chun players is precision. Love these sweeps. Clears it away. Dragon step. Sweep. And being very gentle on this thing, even though it looks like it's well secured, he's not smashing it like you saw some of the work of the HungGar set where they were really hitting it. And even the XingYi set where he rolled around and hit it with his shoulder. This is all very precise. And I guess you could almost say like the snake hand work of Wing Chun maybe is at play here. And it gives you the evidence that it's Wing Chun. If, of course, that story holds any merit in that Wing Chun was seeded by a snake and crane system. If you look at these other systems, I wish I could find a white crane dummy. Didn't have any luck with that. Maybe we'll pick that up in another video. But you can see Wing Chun's a worthy substitute for what would be crane method. You see a lot of cat stances. You see fluid wing redirects. A light-handed method in that we move around the object and we're not crashing too crazy. Of course, you can train this much harder. So he's training this light. And to the point of these other guys, you can smash onto this thing as hard as you want. Right? Very nice. We're going back. We're going back. Opera Wing Chun. So from the Red Bull Opera, they say Wang Wei Bo and Lung Yi Tai were the keepers of the method where the sword and the staff were brought together. Where they shared with each other, and propagated the system. The rest after that is, of course, hearsay and not backed up with a ton of evidence. But we can trace it all the way into the village of Foshan with Lung Jan, who did exist, who has records and has descendants. And you could see his Wing Chun is similar to the look of Yip Man's Wing Chun, but quite different. So we can only assume that Yip Man's method was given to him in either a different way or was modified from his master down to him. And we look at early generation Yip Man and then late generation Yip Man, and there's distinctive differences even there. So was the system being refined, minimalized? I would say yes. This is Yip Man's work, is that he made it even more simple and even more refined. And then his disciples did the same thing and maybe standardized it more. I believe a lot of Kung Fu of this old time period, these are keepers of these old methods. It's maybe not symmetrical and not as standardized. The chapters were less refined or less defined. I love this. He sweeps. You could look at this from a Wing Chun perspective and say this is a keeper of quite a bit more methods and doing things that almost you wish you could be seeing in the Yip Man methods, redirects and more sweeps. But again, I love the he's got great posture, good form, good refined hand shapes. We love lots of Phoenix Eye punches. If you study Wing Chun and you get into the history on it, there was never a regular old punch. It was always a Phoenix Eye punch. And then it's Yip Man that took this punch out because it's quite deadly. You hurt your friends. You practice it a lot. You even mistakenly hit them in the ribs. You can do some internal damage that makes it very hard to heal or just bruises people very badly. Maybe you don't want to give that away to just everybody you meet. And so that's why the standard regular old punch is preferred in the modern scene. But the classic weapons are the Phoenix Eye punch or, you know, finger grabbing or gouging and clawing. Right? Very cool. We're going to keep going. We got one more. Last is not exactly the same kind of wooden dummy that we've been looking at, but a field array of wooden dummies, which you'll see some Bagua players play with just a single post. This is what they're calling Shaolin. And so traditionally, there would be fields of these posts that were put in arrangements, and the players can be on top of them or in between them, like you're seeing this gentleman work. There is a type Wing Chun dummy that's favored, which is called the tri-post dummy. And you could see just quickly, the tri-post dummy is just three of these. So where did it come from? Came from Shaolin. This gentleman is studying it, keeping it. I love this final posturing. Is such an indicator that it's Shaolin. It's just one of the things that they always do, this high block and low positioning. Elbow strikes, high blocks and low positionings. The low horses, it looks like the HungGar. Obviously, I would bet he's freestyling. Is he doing the real thing? No. There's a series of things that you would do on this. Lefts and rights, angulated hits or matching hits, walking around. But you get to see there's such a big library of other things that we could be doing and making a stick and pointing it into the ground. Bringing arms into it makes it even more dynamic. But in lieu of that, even just going into a place in your forest or near your neighboring park, if you can find just a single post, you've already got an apparatus to be able to train this work. If you live in an apartment, you could take the door jamb of a door or open one of the doors and use the center of that to supplement what you could get in maybe one of these training tools. Okay, thank you guys for joining us, and we'll see you in another episode.
Hey, 你先来。